Life was filled with guns and war, and all of us got trampled on the floor. I wish we'd all been ready. The children died, the days grew cold, a piece of bread could buy a bag of gold. And I wish we'd all been ready. And there's no time to change your mind. The sun has come and you've been left behind.
A man and wife asleep in bed. She hears a noise and turns her head, he's gone. I wish we'd all been ready. Two men walking up a hill, one disappears and one's left standing still. I wish we'd all been ready. There's no time to change your mind. The sun has come and you've been left behind.
Oh yeah. Father spoke, the demons dying. How could you have been so blind? There's no time to change your mind. The sun has come and you've been left behind. No. There's no time to change your mind. The sun has come and you've been left behind.
I hope we'll all be ready.
You've been left behind.
I hope we'll all be ready.
You've been left behind.
I hope we'll all be ready.
You've been left.
Church, there's coming a day when everything will change. Jesus is coming back, and he's coming back as a thief in the night. And I hope we all will be ready. Take your Bibles and open with me the book of Revelation. Revelation chapter 14, the very last book of the Bible. Revelation chapter 14. We're going to begin reading in verse 14, and we're going to be talking about that very important day when Jesus comes back to take home his children. Revelation chapter 14, beginning in verse 14. If you got it, say, "Come quickly, Lord." Let's read. "Then I, John, looked, and behold, a white cloud. And on the cloud sat one like the Son of Man, having on his head a golden crown, and in his hand a sharp sickle. And another angel came out of the temple, crying with a loud voice to him who sat on the cloud, 'Thrust your sickle and reap, for the time has come for you to reap, for the harvest of the earth is ripe.' So he who sat on the cloud thrust his sickle on the earth, and the earth was reaped." As is most of the book of Revelation, this passage is also a very unusual passage. But though it may be unusual, this passage here is an extremely important passage. And it's especially important in this day and time that we're living right now. Church, there is coming a day very soon. There is coming a day very soon where everything will change. Our world is going to change. Our nation is going to change. Our church will change. Our family will change. Our our marriage will change, even our life will change. There is coming a day when everything, all of this, will change. And it will change at the rapture of the church. Therefore, my message this morning is entitled, Are You Rapture Ready? Are you rapture ready? Are you rapture ready? Part one. It's entitled part one because there's just too much to talk about the upcoming rapture in just one message. So we're going to start today and we're going to finish up next Sunday. What is the rapture of the church? Well, the rapture is what John is describing right here in Revelation chapter 14. Let's read it again. Verse 14, then I looked and behold a white cloud, and on the cloud sat one like the Son of Man, having on his head a golden crown and in his hand a sharp sickle. And another angel came out of the temple crying with a loud voice to him who sat on the cloud, thrust your sickle and reap, for the time has come for you to reap, for the harvest of the earth is ripe. So he who sat on the cloud thrust his sickle on the earth, and the earth was reaped. Now, after Jesus died and was raised from the dead and ascended back to heaven, after all of that, God took the Apostle John to heaven. Now, whether he took him in a vision or he literally took him physically, it doesn't matter. Either way, God took John to heaven and he told John to write down what he saw. That's why we have the book of Revelation today. The book of Revelation is John's notes of what he personally saw in heaven, whether by vision or physically. Not only did John describe what he saw there, but God also showed John future events. John saw things and he wrote about things that had not even happened yet. John saw things way ahead in the future, and therefore John had difficulty explaining these future things. That is why the book of Revelation is written in such allegoric language. John was trying to describe things he had never seen. He was trying to describe things that he did not understand totally. So he wrote using very descriptive, very poetic language, trying to put into words all these unusual things that his eyes saw. One of the future things that John saw was the rapture of the church. And John is describing the rapture of the church right here in this passage. Now, what is the rapture of the church? We believe that when Jesus comes back, the events of the last days will unfold according to a pre-planned order of events completely orchestrated by God. And they will unfold according to God's plan in a fine-tuned sequence of events according to God's design and according to God's timetable. These are the events in their sequence as everything will unfold in the last days. Corey, I have these on the screen. It will begin with the rapture of the church. Then will become the 7-year great tribulation. Number 3 is the second coming of Jesus Christ, after which will be the battle of Armageddon. Then after that is the millennial reign of Christ on earth. Then there's a final conflict, and then finally and eternally the new Jerusalem. These are the sequence of events for the last days according to God's predetermined plan. And church, all of this will begin with the twinkling of an eye called the rapture of the church. The rapture is God's starter's pistol. Now, church, don't confuse the rapture of the church with the actual second coming of Jesus Christ. They are not the same thing. The rapture and the second coming of Jesus are two totally different events, and they happen at two totally different times, as you see there on the list. The rapture of the church happens before the Great Tribulation, and the actual second coming of Jesus Christ happens after the Great Tribulation. Now, here's an easy way to remember the difference. At the rapture, Jesus comes back just in the sky only, where we will rise up and meet him there in the air. At his second coming, Jesus comes back and sets his feet down on this earth, and he will walk on this earth once again, and he will rule this earth as king for 1,000 years. So please recognize the difference between the rapture and the second coming. They are not the same. same thing. And in Bible prophecy, sometimes the Bible is prophesying about the rapture, and other times the Bible is prophesying about the second coming, and so that's why it's easy to get the two confused. What John is describing right here in Revelation chapter 14, what he is describing is the rapture of the church. And as I said, everything will change at the rapture of the church. The earth will never be the same again once the rapture happens. Let's read it again one last time. And I want you to underline some key words, descriptors about the rapture. All right? We'll underline as we go. Verse 14. Then I looked, and behold, a white cloud. Underline white cloud. And on the cloud sat one like the Son of Man. Underline Son of Man. Having on his head a golden crown, and in his hand a sharp sickle. And another angel, underline angel, came out of the temple crying with a loud voice. Underline that, loud voice. To him who sat on the cloud, thrust your sickle and reap, for the time has come for you to reap, for the harvest of the earth is ripe. So he who sat on the cloud thrust his sickle on the earth, underline this, the earth was reaped. So you underline white cloud, the Son of Man, that is Jesus, the angel, a loud voice, that is a shout, and the earth was reaped. Okay, what John is describing here is an event that has not even happened yet, but I believe it's going to happen really soon. John is describing the starter's pistol to the last days called the rapture of the church. The rapture of the church is God reaping his harvest. At the rapture, God will rescue his church off of the face of the earth as a means of escape from what is about to happen next. God is rescuing his church before terrible days come, because after he rescues his bride, God will then pour out his wrath on the rest of the earth's inhabitants and what Jesus himself defined as the Great Tribulation. We know that the Great Tribulation comes after the rapture by what John writes next. Let's look at it. Verse 17. Then another angel came out of the temple, which is in heaven, he also having a sharp sickle. And another angel after that came out from the altar, who had power over fire. And he cried with a loud cry to him who had the sharp sickle, saying, thrust in your sharp sickle and gather the clusters of the vine of the earth, for her grapes are fully ripe. So the angel thrust his sickle into the earth and gathered the vine of the earth and threw it into the great winepress of the wrath of God. John sees what happens after the rapture, and it is what Jesus defined as the Great Tribulation. John is describing in here in Revelation 14 as the great winepress of God's wrath. Therefore, God will rescue his church. God will rescue his bride off this earth before he pours out his wrath on the sin of mankind at the Great Tribulation. And everyone left behind at the rapture will experience God's wrath. And church, yes, everyone left behind at the rapture will experience God's wrath on this earth during the tribulation, but then everyone left behind will also experience God's wrath for all of eternity in hell. So church, everyone left behind at the rapture will experience terrible days in that seven-year period called the Great Tribulation, but then they will die and go to hell. And that is why it's so important for us to be rapture ready, so you will not be left behind. John sees the rapture, and he's describing the rapture for us right here in Revelation 14. Paul also describes the rapture of the church for us, and what John writes in Revelation merely confirms what Paul has already written in 1 Thessalonians, and let's take a look at it. Turn with me to the book of 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. We're going to look at several passages because I want you to connect the dots. God is the master of connecting the dots, and I want you to see the theme and the importance of being rapture ready. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. Now we're going to see Paul's description of this same event. Let's begin reading in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 13. I'm sorry, verse 16. Here we go. For the Lord Himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trumpet of God. And the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And thus we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. Okay, John in Revelation just confirms what Paul has already written in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. Let's read it again, and we're also going to underline some key words as we go. All right, we're just connecting the dots. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 16. For the Lord Himself will descend. Underline that. The Lord will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel. Underline voice of the archangel. And with the trumpet of God. And the dead in Christ will rise. Underline will rise. Then we who are alive shall be caught up together. Underline that. Caught up together with them in the clouds. And underline this. To meet the Lord in the air. And thus we'll always be with the Lord. As I said, the rapture and the second coming are two totally different events that happen at two totally different times. But Paul here in 1 Thessalonians and John in Revelation are describing the same event. They're describing the rapture of the church. We read here that we will rise up and meet the Lord in the air. Church, this is the rapture of the church described by Paul, and it is just as John saw in Revelation. Paul gives us a further description of the rapture of the church, and I want us to see it. Keep turning to the left. Turn to 1 Corinthians this time. 1 Corinthians 15. As I said, we're just connecting the dots. 1 Corinthians 15, beginning in verse 51. He's given us further information, more information about the rapture of the church. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 51. Paul is writing. Let's listen to what he says. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. As all the nursery workers said, amen. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible body must put on incorruption, and this mortal body must put on immortality. Once again, Paul describes the rapture as he's talking about a trumpet will sound, and we will rise. So far, in John's description of the book of Revelation and Paul's description in 1 Thessalonians and 1 Corinthians, we are given much detail about the rapture, and their details agree with one another. They both agree that we will hear a trumpet blast. They both agree that we will hear the shout of the archangel. They both agree that we will see Jesus descending on a cloud. They both agree that we will see the dead in Christ rise up out of their graves. Then the rest that are alive in Christ will rise up also, and we all, the dead from their graves and those who are alive, we all will meet the Lord in the air. If you have been born again, if you have given your heart to Jesus Christ, and as a follower of Jesus Christ, you will experience this supernatural event called the rapture of the church. It doesn't matter if you've died or if you're still alive, every saved person will experience the rapture of the church as it is described right here. And church, it's going to be remarkable. Amen? It's going to be remarkable because not only are we going to be rescued off of the face of the earth by rising up, literally, by meeting the Lord in the air, literally, but it's also going to be remarkable because here in 1 Corinthians, Paul gives us some more details about what's going to happen to us. He tells us here in 1 Corinthians that we all will instantly be changed. Now, we'll hear that trumpet, yes. We'll hear that angel shout, yes. We'll see Jesus descending on a cloud, yes. But every dead person who died as a saved person, we will see them actually coming up out of their graves out of this cemetery in a brand new body at the rapture of the church. By the way, did you know that all Christian graves and all Christian cemeteries are buried in such a way that they'll come up out of their grave facing the east? Did you know that? All these tombstones out here are facing the east. You know why? Because Jesus says he's coming back in the eastern sky. And those who are alive when this happens, and they're saved and they're alive, they will automatically and immediately be changed from their earthly, temporary, mortal body into their heavenly, eternal, immortal body. Therefore, at the rapture of the church, both the dead and the alive will automatically and immediately be changed. And it'll be changed from the temporary earthly body into the eternal heavenly immortal body. This change at the rapture, that's what Paul is giving us more detail about here in 1 Corinthians 15. So matter of fact, let's just get a bigger chunk of it in order to get the full story. Let's back up to verse 42, 1 Corinthians 15. So Paul's just writing, he's informing the church. So also is the resurrection of the dead. The body is sown in corruption, it's raised in incorruption. It's sown in dishonor, it's raised in glory. It's sown in weakness, it's raised in power. It's sown a natural body, it's raised a spiritual body. There's a natural body and there's a spiritual body. And so it is written, the first man, Adam, became a living being. The last Adam became a life-giving spirit. However, the spiritual is not first, but the natural is first, and afterward the spiritual. The first man was of the earth, made of dust. The second man is of the Lord from heaven. As was the man of dust, so also are those who are made of dust. And as is the heavenly man, so also are those who are heavenly. And as we have borne the image of the man of dust, we shall also bear the image of the heavenly man. Now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood, that natural flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does corruption inherit incorruption. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible body must put on an incorruption, and this mortal body must put on immortality. Paul describes our mortal bodies literally, physically being changed into our heavenly bodies. It will be done automatically and immediately at the rapture of the church. Both the dead and the alive will be changed and receive their new body. Now, wait a minute. I thought the dead were already in the presence of God. I thought Paul had already told us to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. I thought Jesus told the thief on the cross, today you'll be with me in paradise. So what's up with that? Well, all of that is true. Every bit of that is absolutely true. Well then, if all of that is true, then how and why do the dead rise up first out of their graves? If they're already with God now, then how and why do they rise up from their graves? Is this some kind of contradiction in Scripture? Well, there's no contradiction here. None at all. Let me tell you why. Our saved loved ones who have already died, they are indeed in God's presence in this very moment. They were in the presence of God the instant that they died. Their soul and spirit was immediately ushered into the presence of God the very instant that their soul and spirit left their body. Their body that they used while they were on this earth is buried in a grave, and that body that they're done with has already turned back to dust. But they themselves are alive and well in the presence of God in this very moment. Now, they are most likely in some kind of spirit form. Most likely they don't have a physical body like we imagine right now. Most likely they are a spirit in God's presence. If they're not a spirit, then they're in some kind of package that God gave them. God's got all that worked out, amen? But they are in the presence of God. They are alive. They are alert. They are experiencing everything that God has to offer. They are filled with happiness and joy right now. So whatever package God has given them, they are in complete peace, complete joy, complete happiness with God in God's house at this very moment. But at the rapture of the church, something remarkable is going to happen. At the rapture, those who are in the presence of God right now will come back to these graves, and they will rise up out of these graves, and they will rise up with a new, heavenly, eternal, immortal body. They will actually, literally, physically rise up out of their grave in their new body, and they will fly up to meet Jesus in the air. Right now, they have some kind of spirit package in God's presence. But at the rapture, they're going to get a new body, an actual physical, literal body. And they're going to come up out of their grave, just as Jesus walked out of his grave in an actual physical body, so will all of those who died. I keep pointing the cemetery back here. So though all those who died will come up out of their grave with a new body, just as Jesus had a new body. Do you remember Doubting Thomas? How many of you remember him? Martha taught him in kindergarten. Doubting Thomas says, I won't believe it until I see the resurrected Lord. And you remember when Jesus reappeared, he touched the nail-scarred hands, he touched the side that had been pierced, and he says, my Lord, my God. We will have a body just like Jesus has a body. Remember, Jesus ate with his disciples on the shore of the Sea of Galilee. And just like that, everyone will receive a new, literal, physical, eternal body at the rapture of the church. So church, like I said, the rapture is going to be remarkable, and it's going to change everything as we know it. John saw it. Paul teaches us about it. Well, guess what? Jesus himself talks about this very thing. But Jesus describes it from a different viewpoint. Jesus doesn't describe the rapture by describing what we will experience at the rapture, as John and Paul did. Jesus describes the rapture at the church from the viewpoint of those who will be left behind. Let's take a look at it. Matthew chapter 24, the first gospel, the book of Matthew. Matthew 24, Jesus describes the rapture, but he gives it to us from a different viewpoint, the viewpoint of those who are left behind. Matthew chapter 24, beginning in verse 36. Jesus is speaking. It's read in my Bible. And the Bible says this, Matthew 24, verse 36. But of that day and hour, no one knows, not even the angels of heaven, but my Father only. But as the days of Noah were, so also will the coming of the Son of Man be. For as in the days before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying, giving in marriage, until the day that Noah entered the ark and did not know until the flood came and took them all away, so also will the coming of the Son of Man be. Then two men will be in the field, one taken, the other left. Two women will be grinding at the mill, one taken, the other left. Watch therefore, for you do not know what hour your Lord is coming. Here Jesus is also speaking about the rapture of the church, just as Paul had described it, just as John had described. But here Jesus gives us the rapture through a different perspective. He's given us the rapture through the eyes of those who are left behind. Look again at verse 40 and 41. Two men will be in the field, one taken, the other left. Two women will be grinding at the mill, one taken, the other left. At the rapture, for those of us who are saved, for those of us whom God will rescue off the face of the earth before he pours out his wrath, for those of us who will experience the rapture, we're going to hear a trumpet. We're going to hear the shout of the archangel. We're going to see Jesus descending on a cloud. And when we hear this and when we see this, we're going to be changed. Our body is going to be miraculously changed in an instant, in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye. And we're going to see at that moment the dead coming up out of their graves with their new body. And then we are going to rise up with them and meet the Lord in the air. It's going to be remarkable for those of us at the rapture. But for those who are left behind, they won't see any of that. They won't see any of that. For those left behind, it will be an instantaneous disappearance of many, many people. For those left behind, the rapture will happen in the twinkling of an eye and an instantaneous poof, and everyone is gone. Two walking along the road, poof, one is gone. Two working side by side, poof, one is gone. Two students studying in school, bam, one is gone. Two driving in a car, one is gone. Two asleep in a bed, one is gone. Two sitting side by side in church, poof, one is gone. For those left behind, it will be an instantaneous disappearance of many, many people. And church, there will be no warning of its coming. It'll be just a normal day, going about our business, poof, you're left behind. It's too late for you. This is why Jesus describes the rapture not from the perspective that we Christians will experience it, but he described the rapture from the perspective of those being left behind. And he describes it this way so that you will not be caught off guard. He describes it this way so that you will be rapture ready. And so he warns us about it. Look at verse 42. Watch therefore, for you do not know what hour your Lord is coming. But know this, that if the master of the house had known the hour the thief would come, he would have watched and not allowed his house to be broken into. Therefore, you also be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour that you do not expect. We don't know when the rapture is going to occur. It could happen at any moment. There's no Bible prophecy that must be fulfilled for the rapture to take place. Now, there are a few things that must be fulfilled before the second coming of Jesus Christ. Things like the rapture, things like the rise of the Antichrist and the one world government and preparation for the Battle of Armageddon. All of that will have to happen before the second coming of Jesus Christ. But there is no Bible prophecy to be fulfilled before the rapture. It could happen at any moment. Therefore, since we won't have any warning, Jesus says, be ready, be ready, be ready, be ready, and not be left behind. If you are left behind, you will die and go to hell. That's exactly what the Bible teaches. You know, many of you have read the books, the Left Behind series. I didn't read them all, but I read most of them. It's a good book, good series. But they taught that you could be saved after the rapture, that it's like you have a second chance. But that's not really what Scripture teaches. What Scripture teaches is that if you're left behind, you're going to die and go to hell. Let me show you how we come to this. It's from the book of 2 Thessalonians. All the T's are together, by the way. Thessalonians, Timothy, Titus. Turn to 2 Thessalonians. Paul's given us more teaching. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. We're going to begin reading in verse 1. I believe that if you're left behind at the rapture, you'll die and go to hell. And we're going to get to the passage that teaches that right here. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 1. Now, brethren, concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our gathering together to Him, we ask you not to be soon shaken in mind or troubled, either by spirit or by word or by letter, as if from us, as though the day of Christ had already come. Now, Paul here, this is going to be a little confusing. Paul here is not talking about the rapture. Paul here is actually talking about the second coming of Jesus Christ. Remember, the rapture and the second coming are confusing. They're not the same thing, two totally different events, and it can be confusing, hard to differentiate. Just know that the rapture happens before the Great Tribulation, and the actual second coming of Jesus Christ happens after the Great Tribulation. Right here, Paul is actually speaking about the second coming of Jesus Christ. But I want to show you something. Let's just read on, verse 3. Let no one deceive you by any means, for that day is the second coming of Jesus Christ. For that day will not come unless the falling away comes first, and the man of sin is revealed, the son of perdition, who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he, this man of perdition, sits as God in the temple of God, showing himself to be God. Now, Paul is now teaching us about the Great Tribulation. He's teaching us about how the coming Great Tribulation is going to come about. Paul is teaching us about the second coming of Jesus, and then he begins describing the Great Tribulation, which will precede the second coming. Before Jesus returns at his second coming, the Antichrist will bring the world into a one-world government. After the rapture, the Antichrist will bring the world into a one-world government, and he will be evil. He will be the devil's lynchman, and he's going to lead the world into a one-world government, and he's going to take over power of the world. And Paul is talking about the Antichrist here. He refers to him as the son of perdition, who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God. That's what Paul is saying here. And so after the rapture, but before the second coming of Jesus Christ, the Antichrist is going to rise into power during this 7-year Great Tribulation. All right, let's read on. Verse 5. Do you not remember that when I was still with you, I told you these things? And now you know what is restraining, that he may be revealed in his own time. For the mystery of the lawlessness is already at work. Only he, the Holy Spirit, who now restrains, will do so until the Holy Spirit is taken out of the way. And when the lawless one, the Antichrist, will be revealed, whom the Lord will consume with the breath of his mouth and destroy with the brightness of his coming. Jesus will defeat the Antichrist and the armies of this world at the end of the Great Tribulation. It will take place at the second coming of Jesus Christ at the Battle of Armageddon. All right? Now, I know I'm drowning you in end times information. We're trying to take a drink out of a fire hydrant. But we're getting to the point. So just hang with me. Just read a little bit more. Verse 9. The coming of the lawless one is according to the working of Satan with all power, signs, and lying wonders. The devil will be in charge of the Antichrist. And with all unrighteous deception among those who perished, that's everybody left behind, because they did not receive the love of the truth that they might be saved. And for this reason, God will send them strong delusion that they should believe the lie, that they may all be condemned who did not believe the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. Okay, church, this is where we've been trying to get to. As I said, if you are left behind at the rapture of the church, you will die and go to hell. The reason I believe that is because of 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 11 and 12. One last look. 11 and 12. For this reason, God will send them strong delusion that they, all of those who are left behind, should believe the lie. That they all who was left behind may be condemned who did not believe the truth because they were left behind and had pleasure in unrighteousness. All right, here we go. As part of punishment for denying the only salvation that God offers, as part of punishment for rejecting Jesus Christ as Savior, as part of punishment of refusing to obtain the necessary redemption for your sin, God will leave you behind at the rapture to experience terrible tribulation in the great tribulation. But not only will God leave you here for rejecting His Son, but since you would not believe the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ, God will, as punishment for your rejection and sin, God will send strong delusion, and you will never be saved. Your punishment for not believing the truth will be that you will believe a lie, and that you will die, and that you will go to hell. Jesus gives us the truth, and bless God, the truth shall set you free. Amen. But if you deny the truth on this side of the rapture, you will believe the lie on that side of the rapture, and you will die and go to hell. So, church, as I said, if you are left behind at the rapture, you're going to die and go to hell. There are no second chances. And that is why Jesus chose to illustrate the rapture through the eyes of those who will be left behind. And so Jesus does so to warn us. Be ready. Be ready. He's coming back. Be ready. It's like a thief in the night. Be ready. Be ready. And don't be left behind. Because if you're left behind, you will die and go to hell. You will die and go to hell. But church, you can guarantee that you will not go to hell. You can guarantee that you will not go to hell by giving your heart to Jesus Christ right now. That's why the Bible says today is the day of salvation. Don't put it off. Be ready. Now, next week, we're going to continue the message, and we're going to understand why not only lost people need to get ready, but why saved people need to be ready. We're going to talk about that next week. But right here, right now, you can become rapture ready by believing the story of Jesus Christ, by giving your heart to Him, repenting of your sins, asking Him to be your Savior. He'll write your name down in the Lamb's Book of Life. He'll seal it with the blood of the Lamb, and nobody can take your name out. And one day you'll hear the trumpet, you'll hear the shout, you'll see Jesus descend, and you will rise up to meet Him where you will forever be with the Lord. And that's why Paul says, therefore comfort one another with these words. Hey, it's trying times out there, isn't it? Who knows what's going to happen come Wednesday? But bless God, our citizenship is not of this world. We've given our life to the one who gave His life to us. And He's sounding the alarm. And I'm just doing my obedient diligence of what God has called me to do to warn you, be ready. He is coming. Give your heart to Jesus Christ. Stand with me, church. I encourage you to make a decision for Jesus. Tony and Anna Grace is going to come and lead us in a hymn of worship. I'm going to invite you to do business with God. All right? Let me pray for you. Lord, thank you. Thank you that you've told us how it's all going to happen. You've told us how to prepare. You've told us what to do. Thank you, God, that you didn't just leave us in the dark. But because you loved us, you told us what to do. Thank you for sending your Son. And I pray, God, that you'll turn on the light of your truth to the heart of that person that's here today that doesn't know you, that they'll give their heart to you before it is eternally too late. Lord, we want it to be hard to go to hell from Salem Baptist Church. God, call your people to look up with anticipation, because your return is near. Thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.